Your son had a near-death experience.
He saw things that I can't really explain.
Before you see the movie,
Mom was in one room, you were in another room yelling at God.
Get the real story.
I knew that the first person I saw was Jesus.
Colton Burpo shares what's on the other side.
Heaven is for real, and you're gonna like it.
On today's 700 Club.
Well, you're watching the 700 Club, and it's wonderful to see you today. Wendy Griffiths here with us, and it's good to see you.
Good to see you.
We've got a great program today, and we start off, as usual, talking about where, by the way, our dear sister is, the Ukraine. Terry is in the Ukraine.
That's right. Right where it's all happening.
Mm-hmm. Trying to line up orphans or help the gypsies or something. But she's over there, and she'll tell us more about it. But once again, the president's critics are saying he isn't taking a strong enough stand against Vladimir Putin and the military moves going on in the Ukraine.
Now, Republicans are pushing the president to follow through on his talk against Russia. Ephraim Graham has the story.
New provocations, this time aimed at the U.S. as a Russian jet buzzed a U.S. Navy ship in the Black Sea. The jet reportedly made a dozen high-speed passes over the USS Donald Cook for more than 90 minutes.
The message is, we see you, we don't like you in our backyard, and we prefer that you would leave.
President Obama's critics say it is just one more instance of Russian President Vladimir Putin thumbing his nose at an administration that's weak on foreign policy, known more for talking tough than taking forceful action. Obama and Putin spoke for 90 minutes Monday. The White House expressed, quote, grave concern over Putin's support for pro-Russian militia destabilizing eastern Ukraine. The Kremlin says the president is getting unreliable information.
We know who is behind this. Indeed, the only entity in the area capable of these coordinated professional military actions is Russia.
The administration says tough economic sanctions are beginning to take hold and is threatening to ratchet them up if Russia doesn't back down. Some Republicans are urging the president to take tough action now. Senator John McCain said the U.S. should impose tougher sanctions on Russia immediately and ship military aid to Ukraine. Speaking on CBS's Face the Nation Sunday, McCain said Putin is emboldened by the lack of U.S. response. Right now, he's going full speed ahead down the freeway, and there's no evidence of him having to pay a significant penalty. President Obama says he has no plans to send weapons to Ukraine. Ephraim Graham, CBN News.
Weakness, weakness, weakness. You know, it would be so easy to do that. We have mechanisms at our disposal that could crash the Soviet economy. It's no longer Soviet, the Russian economy. We can do that. We also can liberalize the export of natural gas. We could open up. We've only got one export facility for the freezing of the natural gas. That's Cheniere Energy, and that's down in the Gulf, but we don't have any others right now. And the president could take the lid off the natural gas and all the export controls and say, we're going to flood the world with natural gas, and you, Russia, are going to be finding yourself bankrupt. We can do that, and we can do it very subtly. We don't have to go out there with a lot of bellicose talk. The last thing we want to do is drive Putin in a corner where he decides his only way out is to push the nuclear button. We don't want nuclear war. None of us do. And it's a fine line, but the president, his indecision is going to invite something that'll be so far down the road, and by the time we do react to it, it'll be a shooting war, and we don't want that. Well, the president may be having trouble in foreign policy, but he's had no problem recommending higher taxes here at home. John Jessup will learn the shocking story of what he's been doing.
Pat, President Obama has recommended more than 400 tax increases since taking office in 2009. With Tax Day here, Americans for Tax Reform has reviewed the president's record and found that he's pushed for new taxes every year while in office. The group says the president has proposed 442 total tax increases, not including the 20 he signed into law as part of Obamacare. Well, the Social Security Administration is suspending a program that sees tax refund money from thousands of Americans. The program was put in place to recoup money because it had sent out too much in payments years ago. But the people who were having their tax refunds taken complained, and so did members of Congress. They said people were being forced to repay the decades-old debts of their parents or guardians. The Social Security Administration says it has identified 400,000 people with old debts, totaling more than $700 million. It has collected $55 million, but is suspending the program until a review is completed. Last night's lunar eclipse called the Blood Moon has attracted a great deal of interest. The moon crossed through Earth's shadow and took on a reddish hue between 2 and 4 Eastern this morning. We'll see three more before October of next year. According to NASA, seeing four lunar eclipses in a row is rare. But in the 21st century, we'll see a bit more. Some biblical experts have attributed special significance to lunar eclipses since they coincide with Jewish feasts. And you can see Eric Stackelbeck's interview with Pastor John Hagee on his view of the history and potential implications of blood moons by going to cbnnews.com. Pat, those were some pretty impressive images.
I must say I was not up to see them, but Wendy was.
I was. I really wanted to see it, and but I didn't set my alarm. I just thought, you know, if I happened, I sleep kind of light, and I did. I woke up right at 3 a.m.
Yeah.
So I went up on my deck, and I have a real high deck on the third floor, and there it was, the blood moon.
Was it impressive?
It looked just like the pictures that we just showed. Yeah, it really was red, and then by 3:15, it was completely gone, either from the total eclipse or from the cloud cover. So I was grateful I had that little.
Well, it's a thrill. I mean, I like John Hagee. He writes interesting stuff, and this is an interesting take on history. And apparently, a number of key things—the Six-Day War, the 1948 Declaration—all kinds of things have happened dealing with Israel. So, does this mean some tragedy with Israel? Does that mean that the war will start in the Middle East? You don't know. But anyhow, there's a lot of interest in the blood moon. I, for one, have no view on it whatsoever.
But this happened on Passover, which is kind of interesting, I think.
Especially.
You know, the blood, the moon, and the blood of Passover. So very intriguing.
Well, it is intriguing. That's why so many people are interested in buying his book and trying to read about it and find out about it. But as I say, on this one, I don't have any point of view, except the Bible says in the latter days, for the coming of the Lord, the moon will turn to blood. But that can happen through haze. I mean, you can. I think what's going to happen if there is the end of the age, and I wrote a book about it, it's going to be an asteroid strike. And when it does, it'll blow up a cloud of debris that'll fill the sky, and then the stars will have a funny look to them. And the sun will be obscured, and the sun won't give its light, and the moon will turn to blood. And that's the way it'll happen. John.
Pat, identity theft is one of the fastest growing crimes in America, and it's not just your credit cards that they want. Thieves are after your government and medical information as well. And as one Ohio woman recently discovered, it can even include stealing the identity of someone who's died. Heather Sells has that story.
While the family of Amy Reicheld mourned her death, the identity thieves got busy. Their strategy: simply spend $10 to purchase a copy of her death certificate.
Anyone can walk in and they don't, you know, keep track of it. I said, really? And they said, yes, it's public record.
A fact Reicheld found shocking.
Her death might be public record, but all that information you're handing out for $10 is not public record.
Most death certificates contain the full name of the deceased, their address, and their date of birth. In this case, the thieves targeted almost a dozen victims and walked away with tens of thousands of dollars.
The bad guy in this case went onto the obituary section in the local paper, realized that someone was deceased and that they could access their death certificate. Once they accessed that information on the death certificate, they went to the Postal Service, filed a change of address form, and actually got the mail diverted from the deceased individual to their residence.
Evan says the thieves were able to make changes on credit cards and drain bank accounts. The victims' families lost thousands, and in one case, couldn't even pay for the funeral.
It's a very kind of devious and fairly smart way of stealing somebody's identity, because they're not there to care. You know, Amy's not going to answer the phone and be like, what? I didn't open this credit card. What are you talking about?
Heather Sells, CBN News.
Pat, something I've always wondered, if someone's that ingenious, why not come up with something more creative or productive than a life of crime?
It's so much easier. It's a lot more fun, I think, for them. I don't know if the crooks would rather steal than to do it honestly, and they do have obviously some genius. But, you know, I wonder, if I'm dead, does it matter? Somebody's stealing my money. I mean, what can I do with it? I'm dead. I can't use it.
It still matters to your family.
Well, it matters to my family, I guess. And my family hopefully will be well taken care of without worrying about what the identity thieves will do. But nevertheless, with me, when I've gone to be with Jesus, I am not concerned about what I'm leaving behind. As the one guy said, I will tell you how much that man left. And they said, well, how much? He said he left it all. John.
Pat, more than 100 Christian leaders from different backgrounds in different states met at the White House Monday for the Easter celebration of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. White House correspondent Jennifer Wishon has that story.
An Easter celebration at the most famous home in the world.
I think it's amazing that the most powerful nation on the planet, in probably the most important building, politically speaking, in the entire world, that we're having a moment where we are not only acknowledging, but celebrating the resurrection of Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior.
It's a tradition started by President Obama 4 years ago, but this year it began with an acknowledgement of death as the president honored three victims of that deadly shooting at a Jewish center and retirement home in Kansas. A crime committed on the eve of Passover.
And we have to keep coming together across faiths to combat the ignorance and intolerance, including anti-Semitism, that can lead to hatred and to violence. So, this Easter week, of course, we recognize that there's a lot of pain and a lot of sin and a lot of tragedy in this world, but we're also overwhelmed by the grace of an awesome God.
The president's remarks centered around his recent meeting with Pope Francis at the Vatican and included a reading given to him by the Pope.
Christ's resurrection, he writes, is not an event of the past. It contains a vital power which has permeated this world. And he adds, Jesus did not rise in vain. May we never remain on the sidelines of this march of living hope.
Still, the president says, as a rule, he tries not to preach to preachers.
Lord, fill my mouth with worthwhile stuff and nudge me when I've said enough.
Jennifer Wishon, CBN News, the White House.
A victory for a student-led Bible group at a high school in Amsterdam, New York. The school superintendent recently told club members they need to buy an insurance policy to use the school's facilities after hours, something not required of other student-led programs. The American Center for Law and Justice defended the students, arguing the Bible study must be given the same privileges as any other group. The ACLJ said if other student-led clubs are not required to obtain insurance policies, this senior should not be required to obtain one for the Bible club. The school dropped the request, and the group is now free to meet after school. Another example of the ACLJ defending religious freedom. Pat?
That's right. It was my privilege to found that organization, and I must say it's become probably the leading advocate for religious freedom in this nation. And Jay Sekulow is just a fabulous spokesperson for that organization and for all of us. He appears regularly on Fox News and other news channels and is always eloquent and insightful, and I'm proud of him. He's a good guy. Wendy?
Up next, the generation that connected the world now has plans to revolutionize it.
10 years ago, this would have never worked. We can talk on the phone, we can video chat, we can text, and just within seconds, we can make decisions for our little company.
Hear how millennials are changing the way we work next. Still ahead, a trip to the hospital.
Daddy, don't let him take me. Daddy, don't let him take me.
And a visit to heaven.
I was in the throne room of God to start with, so I got to see what that looked like.
The real story behind the new movie.
Colton, you need to go back.
Later on today's 700 Club.
I have a son who's extremely smart and sensitive. He went to heaven. I came back.
One true story has become a worldwide sensation.
You saw heaven?
It's beautiful.
Tomorrow, Heaven is for Real is a profoundly beautiful movie.
They don't believe me, do they?
Some people might be afraid to believe.
That will help many to believe.
Is heaven a hope or as real as the earth and sky?
A perfect family film. Heaven is for Real. Rated PG.
Wednesday.
The angels sang to you?
Behind the scenes of Heaven is for Real.
You don't ever have to be scared.
Is that why you wanted to come back? Show me you weren't afraid?
We'll talk to the stars.
It tells you a story, an honest story.
I got to see myself throw up.
You got to see yourself throw up.
And meet the real family behind the story.
Finally, I realized that he was spot on, and this was true.
Wednesday on the 700 Club.
Well, we've got all these names, Generation Y, Generation X, Baby Boomers, Millennials, and so forth. The Baby Boomers, by the way, aren't the largest generation in U.S. history. That honor goes to a group known as the Millennials, those born between 1980 and 1995. Most of them don't know about a world without computers and the Internet, and they're changing the workplace. And as Millennial Caitlin Burke reports, it isn't always easy.
The struggle to bridge generation gaps is as old as time itself. And now the disconnect between millennials, their parents, and grandparents is one of the widest ever.
Now this millennial generation is entering the workforce, and employers are finding that they're just different. Many of those differences are good, others are a little bit more challenging, but the majority stem from the millennials' immersion in technology.
Whether it's networking, sharing information, or just keeping in touch, millennials often turn to social media.
Where I'm reviewing docs and I need to send a PDF real quick to me so I remember to edit that, or there, a client has an important document, you know, I have an app on my phone that's great for that. You know, you hear, because I follow all this social media, you hear about all of this innovation that can make the work process easier.
But to an older generation, constant use of social media looks like more of a distraction. As a consultant and professional speaker, Donia Story has looked out over her audience and found them focused on their phones instead of her.
It's pretty horrifying when you're on that stage or you're giving a presentation and you look and half of the audience is doing that thing that they're doing.
She later found out that while some of them may have been distracted, others were sharing her speech through Twitter. A simple miscommunication, but one that's becoming more common as older generations try to grasp this technology. Employers say they see the benefits of technology and how millennials use it in the workplace, but they also fear those benefits come at a cost.
The texting and communication without face-to-face seems to become problematic in the sense that our business depends on relationship building.
Experts agree. Author Dr. Tom Rayner's book, The Millennials, takes an in-depth look into the world's largest generation.
I believe that this will be one of the greatest challenges of the millennial generation going forward. There's never going to be a time that you can replace face-to-face conversation.
It's not surprising that this strength, a tech-savvy, multitasking approach, can also be a weakness. Dr. Rayner says employers should work with millennials on their shortcomings and never discredit their strengths. Take Mark and Alex, for example. Out of college, they started working with Manna Nutrition, a company that makes therapeutic food.
It's a peanut butter for children who are severely malnourished. And it's amazing because it can rapidly change the effects of severe malnutrition.
Their mission? Spread the word about Manna's therapeutic peanut butter.
We just stopped at churches, and we stopped at colleges and high schools and anyone who would basically let us come in and talk.
Eventually, they decided they could do more.
It would make sense to create like a consumer product that is in a similar form. So people could buy this product and through that purchase be essentially doing their donation also. We didn't have any money to start with. We didn't have a rich uncle. We didn't have peanut experience. But we had a good audience from the people who believed in Mana's mission and in our mission. So we started an online crowdfunding campaign.
Mark and Alex decided they would need about $65,000 to get their company off the ground.
People were really receptive, and we overfunded. We raised about $70,000.
That was the start of their company, Good Spread.
Every time we sell a packet or a jar of our peanut butter, we give away these packets of therapeutic peanut butter to kids that are malnourished.
Not only did technology play a huge role in starting Mark and Alex's business, it's also helping them keep it going. Mark's based here in Nashville, and Alex is in Washington, D.C.
10 years ago, this would have never worked. But Alex and I, literally every day, it's like a long-distance relationship. We can talk on the phone, we can video chat, we can text, and just within seconds, we can make decisions for our little peanut butter company.
In November, Good Spread sent its first batch overseas through a partnership with World Vision. The total, 33,000 packets. It's a business run the millennial way, and it's making a difference. Caitlin Burke, CBN News, Nashville, Tennessee.
How about that? Our own millennial, Caitlin Burke, and what a wonderful story. Isn't that great?
So what about you and advanced technology?
Well, I've finally caught on to the iPad, which I'm using, and then I've begun to get the keyboard. I used to be able to type. You know, when I was in law school, I typed, and I've given up that skill, but I have to get it back again. So
it's amazing what you can do on your iPhone now.
Yeah. But I don't have one of them. But I tell you, all this code, you know, the BFF and LOLs and all that stuff. I mean, these people have lost the use of language.
It's true. It's true. I'm getting there myself.
Are you? Okay.
Well, up next, a boy who died, went to heaven, and had a movie made about his life.
I knew that the first person I saw was Jesus. He was wearing white robes with a purple sash. And he just came down nicely and gracefully.
Colton Burpo tells us why heaven is for real next.
Visit Vonage.com for home phone service and you could save 39% versus a traditional home phone plan. With Vonage, you'll get over 25 great features plus award-winning customer service. Get Vonage today and save with our special intro price.
I was having some pains between my shoulder blades. At that point, everything changed. Diagnosis, pancreatic cancer.
First, there was prayer. The second is to fight. As soon as we walked through those doors at Cancer Treatment Centers of America, all my anxiety left. The pastoral care here is based on the Bible, based on the Word of God, just as it is at our own church.
When you combine the great medicine with the spiritual resources we have, it provides the patients with something that really can make a difference.
You got a pastor right there on staff praying with patients, and whether it be scripture or whether it just be a word of encouragement to say God's got this.
If you or someone you love is fighting complex or advanced stage cancer, go to cancercenter.com/faith. You'll learn how our treatment results compare to national averages and see a list of insurance plans with which we've worked. Advanced medicine and technology, the warm embrace of the spirit.
I firmly believe God led me here.
Call or go to cancercenter.com. Cancer Treatment Centers of America. Care that never quits. Appointments available now.
To listen to our top songs of the week, go to CBN Radio at cbn.com.
Welcome back. Well, the book Heaven is for Real sold over 10 million copies, spent 100 weeks on the bestseller list, and is now the subject of a major motion picture. It tells the true story of a young boy who got a glimpse of the afterlife. Last year, we had the chance to speak with the Burpos in their home and hear their side of the story.
How old are you today?
3.
And what is your name?
Antonina.
And where do you live?
In Nebraska.
Who's your mommy?
Sonia.
Who's your daddy?
Daddy Coco.
Who's your sister?
Cassie.
That was 10 years ago. Looking at Colton now, you would have never guessed that he almost died in 2003. His father, Todd, tells about Colton's near-death experience in the book, Heaven is for Real.
And he started throwing up into the toilet, you know, and at first we're like, okay, he's got the stomach flu because the doctor said it was going around.
Colton's condition only got worse as days passed. His doctor discovered his appendix had burst. An infection was spreading in his body. Time was running out.
Then we knew we were in bad shape when they say, well, you need to come out to the hallway. They separated us from everyone else. And then someone came to us and started talking to us that we got to have surgery on your kid.
It was tough. Seeing your boy be lifeless when he was a very vibrant child.
And it was at that moment that we were looking at each other. I remember my wife holding Colton in that hallway, just us. He's not even moving. We went to the surgery prep area, and I remember them hauling him away and him just yelling at me, Daddy, don't let him take me, Daddy, don't let him take me. And I went back to the pre-op room where we had left some stuff, and I was finally alone, shut the door. And I just broke down, and I was mad at God. I just was frustrated. Fed up. And I remember telling him, I said, God, after all I've done for you, and now you're gonna take my kid? This is how you treat your pastors?
And I was calling our prayer chain, I was calling anybody that would be on the other line to get Colton on the prayer chain, because it was bad.
We were there in the waiting room for an hour and a half, maybe. Then I remember the nurse coming out, is Colton's daddy out here? I'm like, yeah, well, Colton's in recovery and he's screaming for you. And I'm sitting there with him. And I remember my son in that room then looking up at me and goes, Dad, do you know I almost died? And my first thought was, maybe he overheard the nurse say that, or maybe they thought he was under anesthesia, you know, and he wasn't. But it wasn't till 4 months after we got out of the hospital that we finally listened to our son.
And that's where I got to see heaven. No, Jesus and some angels came and flew me up to heaven.
And I said, so Colton, what did Jesus look like?
I knew that the first person I saw was Jesus. He was wearing white robes with a purple sash, and he just came down nicely and gracefully.
Well, Dad, Jesus has markers. Dad, Jesus has markers. I didn't know what he meant. So I finally asked the right question, Colton, where are Jesus' markers? And he drops his toys down, and he stands up, and he just points, Dad, they were right here. He takes his fingers, points to the palms, then he bends over and touches the tops of his feet and looks up to me, and that's where Jesus' markers were, Dad.
When I was in the throne room of God to start with, so I got to see what that looked like. I was upset because I didn't know what was happening. What God did is he used people or things that I liked to calm me down. From there on, I felt better.
And one day we're traveling together and he looks up at me and, Dad, you used to have a grandpa named Pop, didn't you? And I'm like, yeah, he's really nice. Really? Yeah, you used to play with him as a kid and work with him on the farm and shoot stuff with him. And I'm like, yeah, how do you know that? Well, he told me.
A figure came up and he was Pop. He asked me, are you Todd's son? I said, yes. He said that he was his grandpa, so that's where I met him.
Yeah, Pop, I was very close to him. And he was my most significant male role model when I was a kid growing up. But he was killed in a car wreck before I turned 7.
I was busy paying bills again, because that's my job. And he came up and told me he had 2 sisters. Well, he had to say it several times before he finally got my attention. And finally, I put myself down and looked at him and says, what do you mean you have 2 sisters? No, I have 2 sisters. You had a baby die in your tummy. And I just looked at him like, well, how do you know you have 2 sisters? Well, she told me. And then he proceeded to describe her.
She looked like Cassie, but she had brown hair. And first time when she saw me, she just came up and hugged me.
We knew this was true because he said she kept hugging me. She wouldn't stop hugging me, Mom, and I didn't like that.
Well, I'm not really the hugging type.
I had miscarried the weekend of Father's Day weekend, which made it even rougher. And we thought we'd dealt with it. We got over, we accepted that the baby had died. But when he said he had 2 sisters, I think I was in shock first and then trying to realize, what is he telling me? And so I knew that he had seen her, and after he described her, and he says, she's just waiting for you guys to come to heaven.
You know, as we talked about heaven, and he was telling me all these wonderful details, I just felt like I had to ask him, did he want to come back?
I knew that I was leaving heaven because Jesus came to me and said, Colton, you need to go back. Even though I didn't want to go back, he said that he was answering my dad's prayer.
I remember that prayer. That irreverent, that disrespectful, screaming at God prayer. I was like, he's answering that prayer?
Today, Colton is a healthy 13-year-old and shares his heavenly journey with boldness.
I learned that heaven is for real and you're gonna like it.
I love that line. Well, the movie adaptation of Colton's story opens in theaters nationwide tomorrow. Heaven is for Real is rated PG. And tomorrow we'll show you a sneak peek of that film. Plus, we'll sit down with the Burpo family Wednesday. Pretty amazing story.
It's remarkable, absolutely remarkable. And, well, it's just one of those miracles that God does. I believe in heaven. I believe in a life after death. There's no question about it. And it's nice to see somebody that's been there.
Yeah.
Well, still ahead, we're going to bring it on with questions from our viewers. Paul says, I know the Bible says we have to obey the law of the land, but what happens when our own government refuses to do that? Do we do nothing or do we stand and fight? Oh, boy.
Coming up later, a fighter at heart.
I love, you know, bumping up into girls, trying to start stuff. You know, that was hype for me. That was my high.
Gets the smack down.
That's when I said, I can't do this anymore. I gotta do something different.
On today's 700 Club.
I have a son who's extremely smart and sensitive. He went to heaven. I came back.
One true story has become a worldwide sensation.
You saw heaven?
It's beautiful.
Tomorrow, Heaven is for Real is a profoundly beautiful movie.
They don't believe me, do they?
Some people might be afraid to believe.
That will help many to believe.
Is heaven a hope or as real as the earth and sky?
A perfect family film. Heaven is for Real. Rated PG.
Welcome back to Washington for this CBN Newsbreak. Ohio must recognize gay marriages performed in other states. That was the ruling from a federal judge. Judge Timothy Black called Ohio's voter-approved marriage recognition bans unconstitutional and unenforceable. His ruling doesn't mean the state can perform gay marriages, just that it must recognize licenses from states where same-sex weddings are legally performed. Even so, the Ohio Attorney General plans to appeal the decision. Arizona abortion clinics will now face surprise inspections. State lawmakers have passed a bill removing the warrant requirement for so-called snap inspections of clinics. The law passed mostly along party lines. Republicans believe it protects the lives of women and children, while Democrats say it hurts women's health and access to abortion. The bill goes to Arizona's governor for final approval. Pro-abortion groups plan on contesting it in court if it becomes law. Well, you can always get the latest from CBN News by going to our website at cbnnews.com. Pat and Wendy will be back with more of the 700 Club right after this.
Fifth grade was a struggle. I mean, it was hard for him.
The teachers didn't really understand what was happening with me.
I mean, he was very stressed out.
At K-12, we think every child deserves the best chance to succeed in school. Now there's a tuition-free choice for kindergarten through 12th graders, an online public school powered by K-12. K-12 offers flexible schedules and programs customized for each student. The award-winning curriculum is taught by highly qualified teachers. Textbooks, videos, and materials are all included free. To find out more, call or click today.
That student has no way to fall through those cracks at all because the parent and the teacher are working so hard together that they're gonna succeed.
Since starting online school and being at home, his whole demeanor has changed.
Don't wait. Make a choice that can change the course of your child's life. For your free information kit, call or visit k12.com today.
Here,
were committed to a heritage of rigorous scholarship, dating back over 1,000 years.
And to a faith tradition dating back 1,000 more.
This is how we create a culture of inquiry, where no topic is off limits.
And a culture of hope.
Where anything's possible!
It's the freedom to think for ourselves.
And a responsibility to act on behalf of others.
It's Christian leadership.
Yes, it's time we ask it.
Cambiando el mundo.
And it's changing the world for the better.
It's higher learning.
It's greater knowing.
It's what makes us whole.
It's what makes us regent.
I'm thrilled to report that Lux Vero, which is the MOOC, the Mass Open Online course offered by Regent, has passed 10,000 students already, and it's going 140
wow.
countries,
10,000
just after 2 months. And right now, U.S. News & World Report said that the Regent has one of the top 10 online bachelor's degree programs in the nation. And it has animation, business, cinema and television, criminal justice, international studies, and much, much more. So why don't you log in if you're looking for a school, and if you want to enhance your resume so that you're more qualified for a particular job. Regent has got it. It's just, and you can study online, study at home, and your leisure. And that MOOC is something else. We've teamed up with Can Do. That's an outstanding place, and we've got some of the most creative online programs. The interface is just dynamic. So much for that. So we got questions coming.
What we sure do. Paul writes, I know that the Bible says obey the law of the land, but what does the Bible say about American citizens and Christians defending themselves from our own government that is breaking our laws and destroying our Constitution? Would God want us to simply pray and do nothing, or would he literally want us to stand up and fight against our oppressive, ungodly government? What do we do?
That's a difficult question. You know, when Paul wrote what he was writing, he said we to obey the authorities, and he said, he that bears the sword doesn't wield it, and well, he's there to put down evildoers and to keep law and order. Era that he was writing in had some of the most corrupt emperors, guys like Nero, who were just wicked, awful people. And yet the Christians did not rise up, and Jesus didn't preach rebellion against them. Now, in our tradition here in America, we have believed in the right of revolution. We have a right to throw off tyranny. That's what the American Revolution was all about. And so we have that tradition that in the case of tyranny, we can rise up against tyranny. But that doesn't necessarily found in biblical principles. That's just the heritage here of America. All right.
Yvonne writes, I enjoy playing bingo. There isn't much for older folks to do. And if I win, I give the church a minimum of 10%. I have been winning $40. Is it wrong if I play bingo?
Hey, at your age, go for it. I mean, come on. A few bucks here and there. The reason gambling is wrong, here's the deal. I mean, you're looking at somebody who used to bet on anything and used to play high-stakes poker and the whole thing. I know how it all works.
You did?
I did.
Wow.
Big ones. I mean, but I'd sit there and pray to draw to an inside straight and that kind of stuff. I mean, it's just not good. But what... The problem is, the Bible says, you shall not tempt the Lord your God. Mm. And so what you're doing is laying out your money, putting it on the table, and you're spinning the wheel and hope it'll come out red 16, or you're hoping that the cards will come out so you don't bust in blackjack, or so that you draw it inside straight, or you have another heart and you get a flush or something. But you're praying, and you're testing God, and the Bible says you're not supposed to tempt the Lord your God. That's what it is. But some dear little lady putting a few bucks on the, you know, to play bingo in the church social, I mean, hey,
yeah.
I don't think she's tempting God about anything. So.
I think you're
okay.
Right.
All right. Well,
Kyla writes, she says, hi, I am 11 years old, and I have a question. I have a dream that I see eights and nines all the time. Please tell me what this means.
72.
17. She's 11. Maybe she's thinking she wants to be 8 or 9 again. I don't know.
No, I tell you what, I really believe that what you that says to me is that you're gifted in math and that you have a future in numbers. You know, I was interviewing Rabbi Levin, who's a great guy, and he said, you know, the word for counting in Hebrew, as I recall, was money. It was where we get money. And those who can count were considered to be distinguished. And he said, if you want to have like the Jewish way of doing things, you had to count your money. You didn't know where the money was. So there's nothing wrong with knowing what's going on. But I would think for you, you're looking at something that the Lord's telling you. You have a facility with numbers, and you'd be a CPA, an accountant, or maybe a good businessman. All right.
Interesting. All right. Patrick writes, I have noticed that more women have been wearing red apparel on TV, on news shows, advertisements, and politicians. Every day, there are at least several ladies wearing red. Just today, a Daily Doctor show had a segment with an expert on colors stating that red is the color of arousal. The trend seems to be increasing since 2009, and morals are down. What are your thoughts on this?
Well, in terms of marketing, red screams out and it says, buy me. And so you put red out and it's
wear red power ties.
Well, red power ties. But listen, the women wear dresses because they look good on television. And that color bleeds through on their faces, and so it gives them a glow. That the cameras, you know, it bleeds through. So it's really nice on television. If they wear pastels all the time, it fades into the background. So this stands out against the background. But from a marketing standpoint, the color red, when you got an item with a red color, it tells the shopper, buy me, I'm here, ready to go. I don't know about arousal and all that sex stuff. I don't know anything about that. But in terms of... but it makes women look good, and that's why they wear it, you know.
Amen. I'll have to say amen to that. Well,
all right.
I guess we're done.
Thank you for all those questions. Well, in the remote farming communities of Honduras, it's hard for women to find work. So Operation Blessing is helping them start businesses of their own. Watch this.
After her husband died, Maria couldn't find regular work. In this rural part of Honduras, the only job available was as a farm worker. Unfortunately, she didn't always get hired.
They told me that the job was for men and not for women, because women are not good at hard labor.
Meanwhile, Maria's daughter Heidi has to wake up by herself each morning, eat a meager breakfast, and get ready for school.
I knew my mom had to go to work, but I didn't like to be alone. I was afraid.
Before his death, Maria's husband had planted some crops next to their home. Maria dreamt of doing that again so she could be closer to her daughter. But she didn't have the money to buy seeds and fertilizer. Maria even went to the bank to get a loan to buy seeds. The bank turned her down.
That night, we had nothing to eat. I was so scared about what would happen the next day. What would I do to feed my child?
Then Operation Blessing gave Maria and 20 other widows and single mothers seedling potatoes, fertilizer, and insect spray to start their own small farms.
I couldn't imagine that people who didn't know me would help me like this.
In just 2 months, Maria has made $250 profit from selling her potatoes. Now they have enough money for food and enough left over to plant a whole new crop.
Gracias, Operación Bendición.
I can't imagine that people who didn't know me would help me that way. We love people, God loves people, and we can be His hand extended down to Honduras, wherever it is around the world. We can reach out and help people. And that's just one, a little bit of seed potatoes. It doesn't take much, and suddenly you've given somebody a livelihood. Now, if you want to participate, we'd love to have you as a 700 Club member so that we can do this. And Gordon did something about dreams. You know, people want to know what their dreams are all about. And it's visions of the night, how God speaks in dreams. And there's some interesting things in here. So We'll send this to you if you join the 700 Club, which is just 65 cents a day. It's $20 a month. Or you can just make a one-time gift. Say, I want to help Operation Blessing or the humanitarian arm of CBN, whichever. 1-800-759-0700. Give us a call. Wendy.
Up next, an expectant mother who was targeted in a drive-by.
And they just started shooting. My car got shot up. I'm dragging my daughter while I'm 8 months pregnant, running behind a building to try to get into the apartment.
Find out why she was attacked next.
When you get to a certain point in life, you know what you need and what you don't.
That's why we love Consumer Cellular. Finally, we have a wireless plan that fits us to a T.
Oh, excuse me. Would you sell these separately? I only need two.
Certainly. You shouldn't buy more than you need.
Well, I wish the rest of the world felt that way.
That's why we use Consumer Cellular. You can change your plan anytime to make sure you get the best price for the minutes you use. And they start at just $10 a month.
$10?
Mm-hmm.
Consumer Cellular. Simple plans with award-winning service and no contracts at about half the cost of other carriers. Start your risk-free trial today. Switching couldn't be easier. You can even keep your number. Get free activation and free shipping. Or pick out your new phone at Sears. Consumer Cellular is the exclusive wireless provider for AARP members. Ask about your special discounts.
Call Consumer Cellular at 1-800-789-5039. Go online at consumercellular.com or visit a Sears store today.
Wednesday.
The angels sang to you?
Behind the scenes of Heaven is for Real.
You don't ever have to be scared.
Is that why you wanted to come back? Show me you weren't afraid?
We'll talk to the stars.
It tells you a story, an honest story.
I got to see myself throw up.
You got to see yourself throw up.
And meet the real family behind the story.
Finally, I realized that he was spot on and this was true.
Wednesday on the 700 Club.
From emperors, pharaohs, and kings.
God has been always through the ages speaking to people through dreams and visions.
To scientists, musicians, and even children.
I've had this dream before. It's all happened a couple weeks ago. I've had this dream before.
See the dreams that changed our future and learn what to do when God speaks to you. Visions of the Night. Available now.
Antonina Griffin wanted to live the American dream, get a nice house, give her kids a shot at a better life. But when she tried, she wound up selling drugs, living in the projects, and seeing her kids shot by rival drug dealers.
Antonina Griffin remembers growing up in this housing project in Greensboro, North Carolina. Most of her memories are of the chaos in the community and at home.
I'll look outside on any given day and see the fighting. I can see the guns. Within the home, it was times where my aunts and uncles would fight each other.
You don't own me.
The heck I don't.
No, you don't.
You know who pays this bill?
She and her mother lived with a house full of people. The two were never close because her mom partied constantly. It was her grandmother that wanted Antonina to break the family cycle of poverty and violence.
My grandmother instilled a sense of me dreaming and wanting more to life than this. She used to have us to draw a picture of our houses that we wanted to live in. And I used to always draw this big old pretty house with sunshine in the corner, with me and my grandmother and my brother standing there.
Despite her dream of a better life, she was drawn in by other influences.
Growing up, going to school, I got into fights. As a young adult, I got into fights. That was a way of showing who I really was.
And after Antonina's mom died, her grandmother started taking her to church. But Antonina always fell back on the life she knew. She had her first child at 17.
Everybody I hung with already had a child. So it was like, oh, okay, now I'm part of the clique. I'm having my baby now. I can get on the system. You know, I'll have a little bit of money coming in. I'm not working.
Then her grandmother died. Antonina was devastated.
I got mad at God. Like, I was really upset. Like, how can you possibly... Okay, I understand my mom. I didn't have a connection with my mom. But my grandmother, like, really, God.
Antonina stopped going to church and started hitting the nightclubs and fighting constantly.
I love clubbing. I love being in there. I love the fighting. I love, you know, bumping up into girls, trying to start stuff. You know, that was hype for me. That was my high.
She tried to work, but her habit of partying all night got her fired. And over the next few years, she had three more children.
My mother had three kids by three different men. I didn't want that, although I end up following her footsteps in that area, but I knew, always knew I wanted more.
Getting out of the projects would cost money, and Antonina was willing to use any means necessary.
I had got my first of the month check, and I took that money and I bought some drugs. And my younger cousin taught me how to cut it up, bag it up, and sell it. It was just a habit. Like, this is my hustle. My job is to sell drugs to take care of my kids.
The cocaine business was lucrative, but her hustle was not without consequences.
We're standing on the sidewalk talking, and here comes a car around the curve, and they just started shooting. My car got shot up. I'm dragging my daughter while I'm 8 months pregnant, running behind a building to try to get into the apartment.
Antonina knew she was playing a dangerous game selling drugs, but to her, the risk was worth the hope of a better life for her family.
I'm not sure if the drug money is gonna get me the bigger house, but I saw the bigger house. I saw me and my kids living better.
All four of them.
During this time, her hairdresser started inviting Antonina to church.
What do you think about going to church with me?
I'm like, girl, bye. I don't feel like going to church, not right now. So every time I would go get my hair done, she was like, Tanina, you need to come with me to church.
Antonina started hosting gambling parties to make more money. Then one night, things got out of hand.
They were, you know, so loud and cursing and being so disrespectful, and my kids were back there asleep. So I just shut the whole card game down. I said, get out of my house. And I went in my room and I dumped my money out on the bed.
Then she noticed the TV was on and a preacher was speaking.
It was almost like what my grandmother had instilled in me was awakened by his voice. He's just drawing me in and drawing me in. And before I knew it, I was literally crying. Like, I was bawling in tears. I just started thinking more about my children. What if they would have started shooting and something happened to my kids? How am I going to live with that? That's when I said, I can't do this anymore. I got to do something different.
That message was not just a wake-up call. It changed her life.
I just started praying, and I said, God, I promise I'm going to church tomorrow. Like, maybe two Sundays later is when I went up and really got saved, really dedicated my life to Christ and promised that I would serve Him.
She realized that God had been protecting her and her four children all the time.
I just started thinking about times that I could have been killed, or times that I could have, you know, gone to prison, or times that my kids could have been taken away from me. I would have to say it was nobody but God.
Later, Antonina married Darren, whom she met at church. He was also a single parent, and together they have built the dream Antonina always wanted.
I'm thankful for my husband. He's amazing. He wakes up and he prays over us. He covers us. Me growing up, clueless, I didn't know how to be a mother. I started young. And I thank God and I thank my husband because he actually taught me. And if it wasn't for Jesus loving me, dying on the cross for me, I understand that everything that Jesus went through was for me. He is everything in my life, like everything. I will go all out for Him, you know, because He's been just that good to me, just that good.
He's just that good. Listen, folks, Jesus is really wonderful. He is the Son of God. I was reading today where it says he stood before the Sanhedrin and he said, tell us honestly, we adjure you, are you the Messiah? And he said, yes. And he said, you're going to see the Son of Man sitting at the right hand of the power and coming on the clouds of glory. One day he's coming back again. But right now, he comes before us as a suffering servant. He comes for us as one who died on a cross. Not as the exalted ruler one day he'll be, but he comes as somebody who's humble. He came to Israel riding on a donkey, humble, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And what he says is, will you let me take your burdens? Will you let me give you a new life? Will you let me fill you with joy unspeakable? And if you want that joy right now, don't touch that dial right this second. I want you to pray with me. Wherever you are, I want you to pray these words. Jesus. That's right. Pray with me. Jesus. My life isn't what it ought to be. And Jesus, right now, I ask that you will come into my heart, that you live your life in me. And from this moment on, I will live for you and I will serve you all the rest of my life. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Now, if you prayed that prayer, I want to give you something that's very special. It's called A New Day. If you're starting a new day, it's a little booklet in here with a number of scriptures. You can read it at your leisure. There's also a compact disc that has some very important teachings about what you just did. I'll give this to you free, but I ask you to call right now, 1-800-759-0700. Somebody's here who loves you and is thrilled that you've just said yes. The phones will be available even though this program is off the air, and you can still call in. Well, I thank you for joining us on this edition of the 700 Club. And we leave you with today's Power Minute from Psalm 50. Call upon me in the day of trouble, and I will deliver you, and you shall glorify me. Well, that's all the time we've got. Tomorrow, we sit down with the whole Burpo family and get a sneak peek of heaven is for real. So for Wendy and all of us, this is Pat Robertson, and we'll see you tomorrow. Bye-bye.
Wednesday.
The angels sang to you?
Behind the scenes of Heaven is for Real.
You don't ever have to be scared.
Is that why you wanted to come back? Show me you weren't afraid?
We'll talk to the stars.
It tells you a story, an honest story.
We got to see myself throw up.
You got to see yourself throw up.
And meet the real family behind the story.
Finally, I realized that he was spot on and this was true.
Wednesday on the 700 Club.
Come on, give me that. Bye. Sure, life is busy, but I found a way to make a huge difference in people's lives. I guess you could say I'm changing the world right here from home. I bring medical supplies and doctors to people in need and dig wells so that villagers can have clean and safe water to drink. I make it possible to preach the gospel in over 100 countries, including right here in America. And when disaster strikes, I'm there, providing food, thank you, and emergency supplies to give people hope again. Every day, CBN and I are making the world a better place. Here you go. My life is hectic, so I join CBN through Pledge Express. My bank does all the work, and I know that my gift is being used where it's needed most. So become a CBN partner and join Pledge Express, because you can do a world of good right from where you are. Good morning. Are you ready to get started?